Roy Corman, el piloto que condujo el auto con el chasis número 001 cuando el BMW M3 debutó por primera vez aquí en Estados Unidos en el año 88. Y Roy Corman, ya lo van a escuchar, una persona realmente increíble. Tomen en cuenta, este piloto tiene 78 años y los invito a que vayan a ver el video de la vuelta que dimos juntos ahí en Road America. Así que vayan a Autos Javier Mota en YouTube para que vean esa fabulosa experiencia. Y por ahora, escuchen aquí la entrevista con Roy Corman, el piloto del BMW M3 original.
Well, here at the end of the day with BMW M3 and M4 at Road America, and we have one of the legends that drove the cars, the original cars. So, Mr. Roy Corman, how are you?
Very good. Enjoying the day.
Excellent. Even though it's a little bit wet, a lot of rain, but it's a little bit dangerous for us. So we'll see what we can do out there. But first of all, can you tell us a little bit about the history of you and these cars here in the U.S.?
Well, as I mentioned in my speech, we got into this by winning the championship with the 325, the driver championship and the manufacturer championship.
When was
that? That was in 86.
Okay.
And then the following year, BMW came and said, well, you know, they'd like us to run the M3s. So we started actually with chassis number 001 and 002. So it was a
the original.
Start.
So you so drove the original
actually,
cars.
Yeah, they were actually the first two M3s in the United States.
That's
yeah.
Amazing. So these cars, I mean, the idea behind these cars when they developed them in Germany was to compete. And you got to do just that here in the States.
Yeah. Well, see, in Germany, they were developing Group A stuff, which were parts and things that we could not use. So we had to start off from scratch with the season all underway. So it was well through the year before we really had things going well. And I think the last three races were the first we came competitive. Unfortunately, then, as we got our big 1-2 win at the Glen, the following year, of course, the M3 stayed the same. There were no updates for it for the next 3 years, whereas the Porsches got updates, the Chevys got a bigger engine, the Mustangs got bigger brakes, so it got harder and harder as we went on. But we still were
very
always in the top 10, most times in the top 5.
Yeah, so the original car had a 4-cylinder engine, and you were competing against V8s and cars.
Nissan Turbo.
Exactly.
Yes.
So how was that? I mean, how were you able to do that good?
Part of it was the reliability of the BMW. I mean, we could essentially turn our qualifying times the whole 6 hours, where the other guys would be off 3, 4, 5, 6 seconds toward the end of the race. In the 24-hour race, there'd be an even bigger difference in lap times from the start to the finish. And by the end, we would 24 hours. I remember John Andretti saying, you're not going to drive the whole race at this speed. I said, yeah, you know, you can do it.
It's amazing, really, what the engineers can do with these cars back since those days, right? I mean, those cars...
Yes.
I mean, pretty amazing what they were able to do and still do today.
Well, it was really interesting to me to learn today that the engineer that helped develop the E30 M3 program is the same fellow now that's been in charge of developing the M3 the current M3 M4.
That's incredible. So he has all the history on that. But so these cars are meant for driving. And so tell us about, like, obviously a little bit. I mean, they're completely different, but. Little experience like racing these cars, and probably you have one to drive every day too, or not?
Well, I've driven some on the street, and they make a great street car. I think they're more popular now than they were when they were new. There's people selling them for $5,000-$6,000 more than when they were brand new. You know, they're low mileage, so it's a great car for long distance, or if you want to go out to BMW Club Driving School or something like that, it's probably one of the best cars to do it with.
So you obviously had experience with the BMWs before you got into the M3, driving the M3s. Mm-hmm. So what struck you like as the biggest difference back then when you got the first ones?
Well, my first BMW I bought in 1964 was an 1800 Ti. They told me afterwards it was actually the first 1800 Ti in the United States.
Well, you got two then.
Yes, yeah, so I had two first, and that was the first car that was still running good after I finished paying for it.
Wow.
So that impressed me.
That was a good car.
And I have stayed with BMWs ever since.
Oh, okay. So that's a pretty cool story. And then, so let's talk a little bit more about racing. What were the main challenges? I mean, we already talked about, like, driving against more powerful cars, bigger engine cars, and all of that. But this car can handle and do many other things that those cars couldn't do.
Yeah, we certainly had an advantage in the corners and an advantage braking. I mean, while we had trouble with the brakes overheating, I mean, at any one point, I could outbrake any of the V8s.
Yeah.
And our normal thing was if we, like here, with what they call the kink, we could take it flat out with the E30 M3.
Here at Road America.
Yes, yeah. But if I followed a Camaro in there really close, he would actually slow me. And then as he came out, he'd hit that big V8 and just pull away. What I had to do was lift early, make sure I was dead on line, go through it flat out, so my exit speed would match his torque. I could draft him all the way up the straight, I'd tuck him behind, and I'll break him at the next turn. So that's how we had to drive.
So a little bit of, a lot of ability and technical knowledge of what you can do while driving, but also the car has advantages in that sense, being lighter and smaller and all that.
Exactly. Yes.
Yeah. So what other stories do you have from those days driving the original M3?
Oh, we'd be here a long time.
A short one.
Yes. Well, I think, you know, one of the great ones was when we got the 1-2 finish. It's the only time in the 7-year history of that series that a team got a 1-2 finish. And we were actually running first and fourth. John Andretti was in this second car running fourth. There was a Camaro about 100 yards ahead of him, and they were both running at the same speed. Neither was getting, you know, any distance on the other. Davey was in the lead with a Camaro behind him. As we approached our last fuel stop, John called in and said, the handling's gone away. It's terrible oversteer. So as he came in to refuel, my crew chief jumped underneath, saw that the front sway bar link had broken, and he actually got that changed within our normal refueling time.
Wow, how long did it take?
So we, you know, it was just like a minute and 10 seconds. He got it done. That meant the Camaro came in for fuel at the same time. Both cars came in, Camaro first and us second. Well, we changed quick enough. We got out ahead of the Camaro, even though we changed the sway bar length. Uh-huh. So now the two of them are going together at the same speed, but now we're 100 yards ahead of the Camaro. Up front, Davey called in. He says that Camaro has bumped him a few times, and he's going to just push him out of the way toward the end of the race.
Yeah,
so he said, I'm going to let him by, and I'll just hound him from the back. Well, he pushed the Camaro so much that he overheated his brakes. 2 laps from the end, the Camaro went straight off at the end of the front straight with no brakes, and that left us with our 1-2 finish. So that was certainly the high point of the year.
That was excellent. I mean, thank you very much for sharing all your history here with the BMW. And honestly, I mean, like, you kind of like didn't like it, or you were humble enough to say, like, when you hear about, you are a legend. And you are, I mean, with these cars,
okay. No? All right. Well, it was a great time. We had a good time with the cars, and, you know, I have to give it to BMW. It was a supercar, and, you know, there's not many four-cylinders you could go out there. Well, there wasn't any other four-cylinders we could go out there and run with the V8s and the turbos. Yeah.
So you've driven, obviously, the new one.
Yes, I got out there with it yesterday.
What's your opinion on that?
Oh, it's unbelievable. I can't believe they put so much racing technology into a street car.
Exactly. But, so if you had had that car back then when you started in the original M3, you would have won every race.
Yes, we'd have left everybody several times over. Yes, there's no comparison. You know, it's like comparing an Isetta to the first M3, but to compare the first M3 to the current one. I mean, it's a different world.
Exactly. Well, thank you very much. It was an honor for me talking to you and to hear about your history with the M3 and the BMW. And we're going to, the promise is you can take us in the original car to our lap here in North America. Okay. So we're going to go enjoy that with you.
Okay, very good.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Espectacular realmente Roy Corman en el BMW M3 original ahí en Road America. Así que estamos llegando al final de esta edición especial. El lanzamiento del BMW M3 y M4 en Road America en Milwaukee. Y otra vez los invito para que vayan a Autos Javier Mota en YouTube para que vean toda la actividad que realizamos ahí en Milwaukee. Yo soy Javier Mota, esto es Cristina Radio Network y los espero en otra edición de Autos 060.
Este programa fue una producción de National Latino Broadcasting.